Hi, I'm Dave Taddeo, and this is Coders Tech. It's Wednesday, October 8th, 2014, and this is episode 8. Today, I'm going to talk a little bit about ion guns and ion sources and try and help you understand them a little better and their function and how they operate. A lot of times, ion guns give us trouble. They shut down, they don't work, they won't keep going, they come on and then they shut off again. And that's very frustrating. That can be very troublesome. So today I'm going to go over a little bit about how they work and how they operate, just to try and demystify them a little bit. Okay, typically in optics, ion guns are used for two reasons. One, to prepare the substrate to accept a coating. And number two, to densify coatings that are being deposited so that they are denser and less susceptible to environmental factors such as humidity and so on. Okay, a couple of places that we actually see ions on a regular basis, for some of us anyway, is the Aurora Borealis. We just had a big event a couple of weeks ago, maybe 3 weeks ago. There was some activity on the sun. The sun shot out a whole bunch of charged particles that raced toward the Earth about 1,000,000 miles an hour. The charged particles came in contact with the magnetosphere of the Earth, and those charged particles, like all charged particles, follow magnetic field lines and follow those magnetic field lines to the north and south pole. And when those charged particles came in contact or smashed into the Earth's atmosphere, it ionized the oxygen, and if energetic enough, they also ionized the nitrogen in the atmosphere. And some of you may have been able to see the Aurora Borealis as far south as the mid-US. I didn't get to see it because there was a lot of clouds out those couple of days. Another place that we see ions on a very regular basis is neon lighting. Now, neon lighting is everywhere. But the original neon lighting had neon in it. And what happens is, with neon lighting, is you have an anode and a cathode and a small chamber inside. Inside is neon. And there's a voltage applied, and electrons flow through the neon. And when the electrons flow through the neon, they charge the neon, they smash into the neon, and give it energy. When the neon returns back to its normal energetic state, its zero state, it gives off light, it gives off a photon. And that's what lights up the neon. Neon is a particular color. You can fill this lighting with all kinds of different types of gases to get different types of colors, all kinds of different lights for signs and so on and so forth. So this is another place that we see ions and plasma on a regular basis. And one thing I really want to point out here is we have an anode, we have a cathode, and we have electron flow. Electrons are flowing from an anode to a cathode. And what this really is an electrical circuit. It's as simple as that. In an electrical circuit, typically you have some copper wire, you have maybe some aluminum wire, whatever the case may be, gold in a lot of semiconductor applications or electronic applications. Gold is used because of its low resistivity. But what you have is an electrical circuit, an anode, a cathode, an electron flow, or amperage. And that's neon lighting. Okay. That is analogous to what we're doing in a vacuum chamber with an ion gun. What we have with the ion gun. And in this particular case, we have a Mark 1 or a Mark 2 Commonwealth ion source. For those of you that use these sources, this is going to look a little familiar to you. It's not quite fleshed out with the poles and the covering and so on and so forth. But the essential elements are here, okay? What we have is we have an anode, we have a cathode, and underneath here we have a gas distributor ring, which is on its side here. We have argon flowing through, and argon gas coming out into the center of the anode, okay? When we turn on the ion gun, the filament comes on. This is typically made of tungsten. And when we run a current through tungsten, or a lot of different materials, but in this case, tungsten, we run a current through this, it gets hot, and it emits electrons. So electrons are coming off of the tungsten filament. The electrons, partially helped out by the magnet that's here, and here are the magnetic field lines right underneath our anode here, are accelerated toward the argon that is flowing up through the gas distributor ring into this area where the anode is. We have a voltage applied to the anode. We have electrons flowing off of our cathode. They're being zipped around through our magnetic field lines. And our electrons, along with the anode voltage, are helping turn this argon gas, which regularly is a noble gas. It sits at a zero state. It has no charge at all. And once we smash the argon with the electrons, with the anode voltage going on here, we end up with positive argon ions. And that's what we see when we turn on the ion source and you see that little plasma haze that sits here. We've got a little plasma haze that sits here. And that's our argon ions, our argon plasma. Okay, now we've got an argon plasma going. We've got argon flowing in. We've got our anode on to set to a particular voltage. We've got our cathode emitting electrons. And now we've got this cloud of charged particles in our vacuum. Now what do we want to do with them? We want to maybe prepare some substrates to accept a coating. The anode is positive, and the argon ions are also positive, and these two repel each other. So as we increase the voltage to the anode, we also increase the velocity of the argon ions, or the argon plasma. The argon plasma shoots out away from the ion source, or the plasma source, and our substrate sits up here, ready to be bombarded by our argon ions, okay? So there's some smashing happening here. And on a very, very small, very, very microscopic scale, the substrate is being etched, okay? In particular with ophthalmic coatings or ophthalmic lenses, most of them, I think probably 100%, if not 100%, 99% of them, are dipped in a lacquer or a hard coat to give it a scratch-resistant coating. And what we want to do, especially in this particular phase here, is to break the surface tension or rough up that surface so that the coating will actually stick to the lacquer, to the hard coating, okay? So now we've got that going on. One thing to take note of is in some instances you will see on the tooling, the metal tooling, when you take the parts out of the coating machine, you may see some arcing or sparking marks look a little bit like lightning where the coating is. And what that means is there's too much charge here. It's not being bled away. And our cathode will also act as a neutralizer. And you'll see that setting in the software or on the actual ion gun controller. There's a neutralizer curve. And as our argon ions accelerate away or are repelled away from our anode, our cathode will pick some of that up and close that voltage gap. Close that voltage gap, but it will neutralize some of that so that the argon ions that make contact not only with our lenses to be coated, but with the metal and the steel tooling that we're using, we don't get that discharge. We don't get that charge buildup and then that discharge into sparking and lighting. Sometimes you can see that when you look in the coating chamber and watch things being coated, you can see some arcing and sparking. If you do see that, then you can adjust your neutralization current in order to bring that down or to eliminate that completely. Okay. This is how an ion gun works for preparing a surface to be coated. What we also do with this setup here, with this equipment, is to pack coatings or pack material as they're being deposited to make them denser. And how that works is as we deposit coating material, and I'm going to talk about a material like silicon dioxide for a moment. As we deposit our coating material on silicon dioxide on our substrate, the silicon dioxide is coming out of here. Here's our electron gun, for example, some SiO2 in it, okay? And we're evaporating that, and the vapor is very hot. 1,000, 1,500 degrees, whatever the case may be. The vapor is very, very hot. The vapor now leaves and rises to be deposited on the substrate. And the substrate in a lot of applications is heated up to 200 degrees Celsius or 300 degrees Celsius. And a very important point to make is in ophthalmic coatings, because the substrate or the lenses are typically plastic, or 90 to 95% of the lenses are plastic, you can't heat up the substrate. You can't heat up the lenses to accept that coating. And so the temperature of the substrate could be as low as 50 degrees Celsius. Okay? So now you have material or a vapor, SiO2 vapor, that is very, very hot. It comes in contact with a very, very cold, relatively speaking, substrate, and it condenses and solidifies. If there's a large difference between the coating material vapor and the temperature of the coating material vapor and the temperature of the substrate, the material is going to condense and solidify very, very quickly. And what you're going to end up with is material that deposits like this. And you've got all these holes and gaps. It's very porous. And when you take this material, these lenses out of the coating machine, almost right away, you will end up with, what am I looking for here? Blue. You will end up with atmosphere finding its way into these gaps, and that will change the refractive index of your coating. When you take that out of the coating machine right away, you go and measure it on the spectrophotometer, you will have a particular performance of that coating. And with ophthalmic lenses, you'll have a nice W coat with your AR, and then you allow it to sit for a couple of hours, 3 or 4 or 5 hours, or overnight. And the atmosphere seeps into this to these porous areas here, these gaps here between the SiO2 molecules that have solidified. When the atmosphere leaks in, it changes the refractive index of those layers, whether it's SiO2 or TiO2 or whatever the case may be. And it changes the refractive index, therefore it changes your coating, and now your, in your, this case, the ophthalmic AR is now slightly different. Your color changes, the curve changes, and you don't have what you're looking for anymore. Okay, I'm gonna clean this up a little bit. So what you want to do with our ion gun is, as material is being deposited on the substrate, you want it to be as dense as possible so you don't have that atmospheric absorption when you take it out of the coating chamber. So now we have ions accelerating toward the coating while it's being deposited, and it's giving it a little bit of energy. It's giving it a bump. It's giving it that energy that it needs to move into place. Okay? These argon ions smash into this and pack it. Moves it into place. Now you have a much denser coating. Okay? And I'll very quickly just talk a little bit about the labeled APS. Some of you are using labeled APS. And a very similar thing happens with this. We've got argon gas coming in to the shower ring of our anode tube, which is copper. The cathode, in this case, is that purple material. Cathode is LaB6, lanthanum hexaboride. That's heated up by the heater inside, the graphite heater inside, heats up the cathode, the lanthanum hexaboride. The exact same thing happens with as with our tungsten filament with the Commonwealth gun. This emits electrons. Those electrons come in contact with our argon, turns that into an argon ion, and around the outside of the APS, the advanced plasma sorption labeled, we have electromagnets. We can control the current through the electromagnets to increase or decrease the magnetic field strength. The magnetic field strength is what kind of pushes out, gives us the velocity of our argon plasma. It comes out the top there, you'll see that, and does the same thing, prepares our substrate and or gives us a better packing density for our coating material as we're depositing it. Okay, so that's ion guns. I hope that I've been able to help a little bit with that. If you have any questions about ion guns and how they work and settings and so on and so forth, you can email me at davetaddeo@coderstech.com. One other thing I just want to talk about really quickly is I'm doing a free webinar on October 29th at 1 p.m. Eastern. You can go to coderstech.com and find the link to register to that. Please feel free. Anybody can sign up and register and watch that. You don't have to be in ophthalmics, but it is an ophthalmic AR webinar. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.